preaching. Because those who will vote, they won't listen to those conversations. And those of us who will listen to the conversation will be watching the event on the television. And that is the problem that we have. So, in 2019, 90 political parties or more were registered, 73 fielded candidates for presidency. And some gave us very, I don't know what to call it, rasmatasa. And they said that they have almost 2 million followers on social media. And that will translate to, you'll be surprised, even 24 hours to the election, they were still assuring us that those social media will translate to economic, to votes for them. But we know that at the end of the day, only two parties were of consequence. And those two parties are what we should really be talking about. Let's talk about the PDP, briefly. So the PDP unveiled its manifesto. It's a 63-page document. And it's, let's get Nigeria working again. And it's very intriguing. Let's get Nigeria working again. Has Nigeria ever worked? Did Nigeria actually work during PDP era? So for me, it's an abnormality that anybody will come up with this kind of slogan. Because you are saying, let us go back to where we were before 2015. In any case, the manifesto has three missions: security, unity, and prosperity. Unity, which means we should all come together and one, because they believe we have a divided house now. And then security, everybody knows we need security. And of course, prosperity. There is no campaign in any part of the world that any politician would do that will not touch on economic issues. And it's much more for us in Nigeria, because that is where we have the problems. So prosperity is part of what Atiku talked us about. And in talking about prosperity, he said, our vision is to transform Nigeria into a modern economy that works for its people and capable of taking its rightful place among the top 20 economies of the world. My economic policy will be job-centered, especially for our teen youth population. So he identified the issue. Youth unemployment had become 35%. Every 100 young people, 35 of them are doing nothing. He identified it correctly. He also said he will move the economy to 20. Currently, Nigeria is number 30 when it comes to the economy in the world. But when you look at our population, Nigeria is number 7 in the world. But in terms of productivity, we are number 30, which means we are already lagged behind. So, and he said, and this is just one topic, I mean, one major issue I'm picking out of that manifesto, that the economy, the PDP government will move the economy to $900 billion. By 2025. So that means they will move it from $376 billion that it is today to $900 billion. That's almost 200% growth. So for those of us who are not economists, it's something to go to the market with and talk and campaign for PDP. But for those who are economists and we look at where we are coming from, we know it's a political statement. Because when you attain $900 billion US dollar economy by 2025, then Nigeria will become number 14 or so. We'll just be slightly, if all the other economies don't grow at all, we'll just be slightly below Netherlands. And we'll slightly be above Saudi Arabia. That's where the Atiku presidency intended to take us to. So we know that it was a soapbox thing. It's something that they wanted us to hear. There is no way they could have driven us from $376 million economy to a $900 million economy, no matter what we do. But what is important for a PDP government is that it's going to be private sector-led economy. That's what they were going to be providing. Now, on the APC, And this also was very intriguing and very interesting to me. And I wonder maybe people like SAS didn't assist them to draft the manifesto. The vision of the APC was to chart a new course for a better future. And the slogan is the next level. Now, for a government that wants to go to the next level, please hear them. Because it means that some work has been done before. Okay, so I didn't put that here. But the introduction to the manifesto just reflected as if they were not the one in government since 2015. They still talk about all those things I've talked about, condemned all those things, unemployment, poverty, and all of that. Meanwhile, they were the one in government for those 4 years. So if you are moving us to the next level and we are still where we are, I don't know. But they said, the manifesto said, the primary purpose of good governance, which is the welfare of Nigerians, and will strive to eliminate poverty and create job opportunities for all. So you can see both of them identify what the issues are, job opportunity. Because they know that that is what Nigerians want to hear. That's what Nigerians need. And the manifesto identified 8 areas that they are going to be focusing on. War against corruption, food security, accelerated power supply, integrated transport network, free education, devolution of power, accelerated economic growth, and affordable healthcare. By the time you solve all of this, what happened? There's no problem again in Nigeria. We are will be in the state of El Dorado. But the president was very smart. The president didn't talk about all those things. The president consistently talked only about 3 things. What are those 3 things? Revive the economy, secure the nation, and fight corruption. He was very, very consistent. I like him. He is very consistent. So all of you, the rest of you, Anechi, you can be talking about other things. But for me, these are just the 3 things. I will focus on the economy. I will focus on security. And I will keep on fighting corruption. And those are the things that he talked about. And I need to talk more about that because now I'll be moving now to opportunities. Because it's APC government that won the election eventually. And so I will talk more about the manifesto than on the PDP manifesto. So 3 things came out of the manifesto that we should pay attention to. First is the fact that they said they will deepen the economic recovery and growth plan. You know, when the economy went into recession, they came up with a very fantastic blueprint. Very interesting, very fantastic. You can't fault it. And they started working with us since April 2017. And the focus of that was to see how the economy can be turned around again, how production can be improved upon. There are about 6 pillars of the ERGP. So government says, the APC government during election said they will deepen that. And I think one of the things we should look at is what's the content of the ERGP and what can we take away from it that will benefit us. The second thing they also said, which is also very intriguing, is that they said they are going to open, government will open about 5 new banks. They will retouch one and they will open another 5. They will retouch the Bank of Agriculture. Okay, Bank of Agriculture has always been there. So government will retouch that. Then they will open bank for construction and infrastructure. That means there will be a dedicated bank by government to focus on those who are in the field of construction, housing, and all of that. Second, they will open bank for education, which means there will now be scholarship schemes for citizens to go to university. Third, there will be a bank for commerce and small enterprises. So the BOI is focusing on the industry. They're now going to open another bank that will focus on small businesses. Then Bank for Health and Social Services is also part of what they said they will do. So these are things that we should pay attention to that we'll discuss about later. So when you look at the 2 of them, I told you, the APC is to the left. The PDP is to the right. one tilts to the left, one tilts to the right. The APC government is not interested, is interested in government doing a lot of things by themselves. They will establish banks. They will provide petroleum at affordable prices. They will never sell our assets. So the tilting toward welfareism, a state where governments participate much more actively in the economy. Compare that to a PPP government that was focusing on capitalism. They said they will sell all the major assets, including the NNPC. They will provide opportunity for the private sector. They will deregulate oil prices. And those will be called capitalist orientation. And that's why the elite fell for the PDP. Because under that government, private sector had opportunity to do anything they want to do. Under the APC government, there's still a lot of guidance and a lot of ownership of institutions and very critical element of the economy by the government. That's what separates the two of them. But what makes it bad for us as a country is that the players in the two camps, they move easily from one to another. So how can one that belongs, believe so much in welfareism, and the other one believe so much in capitalism, and people are able to move freely there? It shouldn't be. Politicians that have purpose, that have cause, that have values, that believe in doctrine, should not be able to move freely between the two of them, because the ideologies are very different. But that's not what we see here. Alhaji Abbas is here now. If they don't give him ticket, he moves to SAS tomorrow.
He has refused to move.
But our brother has refused to move.
Yes.
So which means he's one of those few people who believe in the ideology of PDP, of all capitalism. Of course, the SAS people came in and said, mantra of change. Change means there will be more mobilization from states, resources. We will not allow capitalists to take advantage of you. The state itself will do more for you. We will open more institutions. We will not allow oil prices to just go to 200 or 300 naira and so on and so forth. That's where we find ourselves, which is very, very, it's neither here nor there. Now, so what should we expect? Now, what should we expect from governments? Number one, from the ERJP, there are certain things that we should expect as individuals and associations. First is that there will be a lot around making ease of doing business better for each and every one of us. And government is doing quite a lot in that area. Now, I think within 14 hours, people should be able to register their business. Now, when, I don't know, has the president signed the new Companies Alike and Other Matters Act? So if he has signed it, one individual can now own a company. Unlike before, when you need to put the name of your husband and the name of your wife, minimum, because by the old act, you need minimum of two people to own a company, to register a company. So they made that very easy for us. So, and the message there is that for all those our small businesses, we can really register them and make them to be legitimate businesses. And we can separate them from our own individual assets. The beauty of that is that when you own a company, so I can have Tunde Popoola Nigeria Limited, shareholder, Tunde Popoola. Before now, if I have Tunde Popoola Nigeria Limited, I have to join Tunde Popoola to be also a shareholder. But I don't need to give her that opportunity anymore. I can only own my company. Government has done that for us. We should leverage on that. So all of us who are sole proprietors, sole owners of businesses, let us take advantage of that. And they also made it so easy that within few days, they said within 14 hours, and I don't even need a lawyer to do that registration for you. Because lawyers make some simple things complex.
They are sitting beside each
other. If you write one sentence for two lawyers, they will interpret it differently. So the thing is simple. If you just tell us this is the industry you want to operate, the members, there are object clauses that have been stated that you can download and just go and register your business. So that is something that we should credit this government with, which I think they will take it. I attended the PEBEC Awards at the Villa on Wednesday, and I could see the Vice President was very eager to do more in that regard. So we'll see more of friendliness for SMEs, of the environment for SMEs, and we should leverage on that. Then the second issue we should also leverage on is what I call socialization of access to finance. This government has been doing trader money, they have been doing all manner of things. People say it's corruption. People say it's political, it's for campaign. But after they come back in June or in May, I think they will go back and do more in that regard as well. So those of us who have cooperatives, you have Asalato, who have all these things, we should find a way to see how we can key into those skills. We shouldn't allow that to pass us. And because the government, like I said, the APC government is more welfare oriented than what a PDP government will have been, more of such schemes will still come during this dispensation. And we should take advantage of that. So I think I want to encourage us to do that. The second one in that area is also about the banks that they are going to establish. Even before they establish those banks, there are currently a lot of intervention funds. 1 million naira, 2 million naira, 3 million naira. National Microfinance Bank just took off. On that Wednesday, one of the companies on which I serve as a chairman in Abuja already had an offer of 10 million naira. So we should look into National Microfinance Bank and some other ones like that. What are their offerings? Is this something we can take advantage of? This is one way, because the government believes so much in such in inclusion. The PD government doesn't believe in inclusion, they believe in capitalism. But the APC government believes so much in inclusion that poverty, they need to do something about it. That more and more people should have access to means of production. More and more people should be able to work for themselves. And so they do a lot in that regard, and we should take advantage of what they are doing in that regard. Even the central bank has done so much in terms of special funds. Let me give you another example. On Wednesday, today's the beginning of another week. So last week, the CBN came up with another 200 billion export intervention funds. The whole essence is to encourage Nigerians to grow some agricultural products for exports. And they mentioned 5 items. They mentioned oil palm, they mentioned cocoa, sesame seeds, chia seeds. The shea butter seed, I mean, that grows on its own in my community in Oyo State. You know, cashew, these 5 items, government will begin have a 200 billion fund that have been earmarked by the central bank. So those of us who are in that area or in that line of business, it's an opportunity for us that we should not lose. Cashew, cocoa, sesame fruit, shea butter, oil palm. We shouldn't lose them. Then they also tell about 6 priority areas: agriculture, manufacturing, solid minerals, services, construction, and real estate. I won't pick each of them one by one because of time, but I want to give enough time for us to discuss. But you're going to see a lot around funding for agriculture. You're going to see a lot around funding for, you know, garments, fashion. You're going to see a lot around funding for tourism, for construction, for real estate. You're going to see a lot of funding in that regard. So we should take advantage of that. The other issue, I think I've taken this. The other 2 things I want to take on this slide is also about investment of our funds. Before now, those of us, the rich people among us, do not have opportunity to invest our money with the banks because of the interest bearing issue. But government has promoted sukuk as a means of investment opportunity. So they have done two sukuk. They did one, 100 billion, very successful. They did another one 2 months ago, 150 billion oversubscribed. So if you have funds, if you cannot invest in treasury bills, you cannot invest in treasury bonds, you can invest in sukuk. It's a window that has been created for us Muslims to take opportunity and use it to invest. So you cannot say, I don't know where to put my money. And those funds are also traded because they are tradable instruments. When you approach your stock brokers, they can, even if it's 5 million naira or 10 million naira you have, they can always invest it for you in sukuk. And you get your returns that is halal as means of returns. So I think I should mention that. The last one I should mention is also about access to finance. And I'll talk more a lot about this. There really cannot be any empowerment if there's no access to funding, to finance. There's that relationship between economic development and access to finance. One of the reasons why, even in this poverty thing we are talking about in Nigeria, one of the reasons why the Muslims are the more affected is simply because we don't have access to banking services. We don't have access to banking services. I have very interesting statistics to back that up. In the whole of Yobe State, there are only 2 microfinance banks. In the whole of Sokoto, there are only 5 microfinance banks. In the whole of Northeast, North Central, and Northwest, combined together, there are 298 microfinance banks out of about 1,000 microfinance banks. Those three regions of the country occupy more than 50% of the population. But they have less than 30% of the banking services. In fact, the totality of the banks, branches of banks in those three zones is just 423. In the FCT alone, there are 421 branches of banks. So there's no access to finance. And where there are people who don't have access to finance, you always have that challenge of being able, even if you need only 3,000, you can't get it. But the message for us here from this government is that they have allowed microfinance, non-interest banking microfinance bank to come up since 2017. So Muslims can now establish banks. The commercial banks, we have only 2. There is, and then there's a new one they just licensed, it's called Taj, non-interest banking. They haven't started operation, but they've gotten their license. Then of course we have about 2 more, maybe Sterling and I think they have stopped. So we don't have, and we don't have, and we say we don't want to participate in interest bearing anything, then we have to use our own money. Where is the savings? We don't have savings. So we are poor because we are poor. We are poor because we are poor. The base is weak. And this government has opened up. What makes it sad for me is that when I look at this, since 2017 when they gave us this window, I've not seen many MFBs that are Islamic banks that have been opened. Yes, they gave us the opportunity. We called for it and they gave us that opportunity. When I delivered the independent lecture of the Supreme Council in September 2017, one of the things I solicited for was that all the, you know, development banks should have window for Islamic bank products, the BOI, the BOA, Nexim, NAFON, Federal Mortgage, all of them. I advocated that governments should compel them to also have products that are Islamic compliant. And after that lecture, I did a one-page memo to the Sultan, through Professor Lorede, that of all this lecture, of all this, my 22-page lecture, the only thing I wanted to pursue the government is this. And I've always made that campaign since 2014, when I also featured on NASPAT program, that NASPAT should take it and champion the fact that all development banks in Nigeria should, you know, galvanize Muslims and do an advocacy to have Islamic window products for all those development banks, because they are very cheap. They can get money cheaply from them. And I think last year, the government acceded to that request. So all of those banks now also have Islamic windows that we should be able to leverage on. So it's left for us as individuals, as companies that do not want to take money on interest-bearing products to use that those windows and see what we can do with them. Don't let me end this lecture without talking about Lagos State, because this is where we operate. Lagos State government, we have a new government that's also coming in May of May 29. The new government campaigned on a platform on those five issues. They talk about traffic management and transportation, they talk about health and environment, they talk about education and technology, they talk about making Lagos a 21st century economy, and they talk about entertainment and health. And they call it team. And in that document, they spell out 27 items that are related to the private sector. And I'll bring out only four or five that I think you can benefit from. The first one is the support to grow the local economy. So the Babajide Sanwo-Olu government says they will promote local content and development for MSMEs. You know, Lagos is home for small businesses. And the government says they are going to really create industrial hubs. He said they are going to start with three. When you have industrial hubs, what it means is that there will be concentration of activities in certain areas. You know, we have Agbara, we have Ikeja, we have Ilupeju. Things like that is what they are looking at this time around for SMEs. And what you're going to be seeing is that if you are somebody, for instance, that makes furniture and you don't have equipment to make furniture, you can take your plant to that location and make your furniture. If you are someone that has, maybe you are pottery, you make pots, you can take your, hammer? Yeah, clay. You can take the clay to that industrial hub, make your clay, because the material, the equipment will be there. You just pay them for using the equipment. So you don't need to own means of production. They said they are going to look at that. So if they do that, so those of us into fashion, into furniture, into all of those trades, and we want to manufacture small things, we don't have the big equipment. This government says they will provide that opportunity, so we should be on the lookout for that. Then they also said they will go into the LSCTF. I think the criteria invited the LSCTF some time ago to talk to us. They said they were going to increase that by 100% access to that. What I don't know is whether we have succeeded in getting them to have a window for Islamic products. If you have not done that, we need to do that. We need to engage LSCTF and say, we want some of these funds for Muslims who do not believe in your interest. Even if that your interest rate is 1%, we don't believe in it. So it's not about the cost, it's about the principle behind it. So earmark a 300 million, a 500 million, a 1 billion naira for us that will basically focus on talking to and funding the businesses of us. Then they said they are going to do a lot of school rehabilitation. So those of us into construction, selling plants and all of those things. I think there will be an opportunity for us in Lagos, because if they are doing school rehabilitation, they will do reconstruction, they will do roofing, they will do tires, all of those materials. It's an opportunity for us that we should focus on. Then there will be technology hubs. This is for our young people. They already have one in Yaba called Yaba Silicon Valley. They're going to have more of that, and they said they are going to have that in all the local government areas and all the FCDAs. I think our people, where they teach people on how to do code, how to code and all of that. So computer science. And you don't need to be a graduate of computer science, really. There are people who are into these things, did not even read, they didn't read computer science in the university. It's about interest, it's about opening up your mind. And I'm talking to the young people now, to be ready to do new things. And this is the direction the world is going. So if the government is providing that opportunity where you can learn how to code and how to learn basic skills on computer, I think we should look forward to it. Then they also said, in addition to that, is skill-based training. There will be some level of vocational training that will come up that they are going to be doing as well. And then they will leverage technology to drive governance and enhance government service. Where this is important for us is because Government's wahala on taxes and payment of rent is too much. When you want to pay, you can spend the whole day there not being able to do anything. So when they use technology for public service delivery, some of these things will be, you know, will be faster, and then you may even be able to do some of them from your office. Today, for instance, from the FIRS portal, when you pay your withholding tax, you don't need to go to the office to collect your receipt. You can download it online. That's where we are moving to. So when they do all of that, it makes life easy for small businesses. And you know why that is important. So when you go, when you can do all of this online, then you don't need to go and pay somebody who will be asking you to pay him 500 naira or 1,000 naira bribe. You can then sort out all of that yourself. So, what are the challenges? I have two more slides to go. The challenges we face as Muslims and as Islamic organizations for me are those three. The first one is the issue around poverty and ignorance and weak social safety support systems. I told you that the Muslims generally have the higher proportion of poor people in poverty. And it's all over, even in Southwest, as rich as Southwest is when you look at Nigeria, we are the one that has significant level of lack of social safety nets. If a Christian loses her husband, the church will take him up. If a Christian is unable to pay the school fees of her children, there is highly possibility that some churches or some Christian association will take it up. We don't have such social safety nets. We don't have many of them among us as Muslims. So, and that exposes us a lot to a lot of danger. And this is an area that I think is still a challenge for us. And the reason why this is also much more so is because a lot of the programs that I've mentioned, and a lot that I did not even mention, but which we can look at, we are not even aware of them. And some of our own counterparts take advantage of all of these things. In the funding part, we don't touch them at all, which is a minus already, which means we are starting on a lower level to move. The second one is a lack of access to financial services. I think I've given some statistics in that area, and I think we need to do something around that. The third is lack of skills and diligence. This is a general Nigerian problem. People don't have skills, so what they produce is not good quality, and they still want you to buy good quality. We have people who left school, they don't have the skills, they cannot even speak good English, yet they want you to employ them on the basis of I am a Muslim. There's a challenge in that regard, and we have to do something about that. Like I said, I